Hello everyone, and welcome back to my Kolonization series in Kerbal Space Program 1.2. In this episode, I'm going to start off by trying to resolve my power situation on the moon, and I've settled on delivering a power distribution unit rather than using one of the other little packs. So, if you recall, we had a choice here, and we had this Ranger Scout 200 power pack, which lasts for a very long time, and it's got input 0.02 per day, and it's got a whole lot of plutonium, but it's got enough for about 1,000 days. Electric charge is 50 per second, but it's very expensive. It costs 80,000. And here we have the MKS power distribution unit, and this one provides 750 per second, which is a lot. But it takes 0.06 enriched uranium per day, and it only has 10. So, well, there you are. I think I'm going to send this one because it is cheaper than the other one. It uses uranium rather than plutonium, I guess. But it will run out quicker. Also, I think it needs a Kerbal in. And I'm just going to send a Kerbal over. And we'll have an engineer and a pilot. And, of course, whether we need a pilot is dubious because we've got a controller on it. We've got the orange. I've replaced the orange's engines. They used to be Twitch engines, but I'm now using these little guys. They are, let me look for them, there they are. This Ma'at radio liquid fuel engine, which has better ISP, but it's heavier. It's basically an LV-909 with 80 kilonewtons of thrust. Only 2 degrees of gimbal range, which is why I put an extra reaction wheel down here. But yeah, this is a fairly straightforward launch, hopefully. But I've added some complexity. The second stage is a skipper, and you can see that that delivers 2,689 meters per second. The first stage is actually the colonization core that we had before, except instead of having the parachutes all over the place, I put the parachutes on the bottom, given it some air brakes, so that it's intended, we're not actually going to manually do this, but intended to land this side down, that side up. And so that's why it's oriented like that. And then it's got the lander legs here, as you can see. This may be a horrible idea, but we're going to let stage recovery deal with it this time. Stage recovery can, of course, handle a lot more than I can. If I tried to bring it down, I'm not too sure it would be successful. But stage recovery says 5.9 meters per second for it, so that's pretty good. Now, I'm trying for the first time these guys, which are air-augmented solid rocket boosters, because I wanted a little bit more thrust-to-weight ratio initially, and I wanted something that I wouldn't have to put on decouplers and was relatively cheap. So these are cheap, and they're not going to last very long. They consume 5.5 solid fuel per second, and they've got 70, so we're talking about like 12 seconds worth. So 12 seconds worth of boost, and then after that, hopefully, we'll be on our way. But they're just gonna remain attached to the stage and come back down with it. And that is the plan. There's some staging error here, so let me sort that out. Okay, so that's the idea. I guess we'll get on with it. We do have a station on its way to the moon, if you recall. It's actually the cupola module, and that was to fulfill this contract here, build a new orbital station around the moon. That will be attached to the existing station at the moon, but right now it's just on its way. We will also try and take care of this new surface outpost on Minmus, but let's get this launch going first so that finally our moon base will be fully operational. Okay, here we are. Oh, I forgot to mention, I think I put some supplies in their inventory. So if you take a look at Georgie's inventory, he's got drills and 2 connector ports, and so does Samrina. So they've got that going for them. So if we want to use the connector ports to connect the existing sort of power, the carbonite power unit to the base, we can do that too. Okay, SAS on, throttle is up, and, well, hopefully everything goes well. Here we go. date. It's still a relatively slow launch. I wouldn't say that the SRBs are particularly strong here. Anyway, it gave us a start. We'll be going straight up for a little while. Thrust weight ratio is too low to do anything else. That's fine, this is supposed to come back down, and the closer it is to the KSC, the better. Supply-wise, it looks like on here we've only got 7 days, but it should have a supply sharing within 150 meters, so we're gonna try and get it within 150 meters of the base, and then it can have supply sharing with the base. Oh, not supply sharing, hab sharing with the base is what we want. And it actually has 75 days of supplies. Don't know why I wasn't reading that properly. But yeah. Apparently the reactor core is not a particularly good habitat. We could have added habitat stuff to it, but I'd rather that they just use the rest of the base as a habitat. We'll see how that operates. Okay, 3 more seconds. And set. And ignition. Before it flips around. Gotta make sure you ignite the engine before it flips. Okay, and this skipper stage is expendable. It is not meant to be recovered. Okay, fairing set. Okie dokie. I get the feeling that the orange is gonna have to do more work than I originally intended it to do. It was just supposed to get the module into orbit around the moon and then land it. And then of course get back up itself. Not too sure that we're actually going to be able to transfer to the moon with this stage. It'll start us off, but I don't think it can finish it. It's got about 500 meters per second to give us. Okay, we'll coast to Apoapsis, and then we'll see whether we really need to circularize into orbit. I think we can maybe transfer before we do that. We're not rendezvousing with the station, we just need to make sure that we end up in a high inclination eventually, but yeah, okay, looks like we have a transfer there, and so we don't even need to get to Apoapsis, and our periapsis will remain low. Let's make sure our antennae... Solar panels aren't strictly necessary, we've got a nuclear reactor here. I don't know if the reactor... it hasn't been started yet, though. So probably let's not do that just yet. As far as the first stage is concerned, it looks like we've recovered it. Recovery percentage 96.5%. Excellent work. Terminal velocity is a little bit high, but we'll take it. Okay, here we go. And next. Hold on. I sense that that's not operating the way it's supposed to. These apparently are blocking the way. Alright, that's better. We'll extend the solar panels on the orange. They are, the thrusters are tilted out specifically so that they don't hit anything on the payload, but the solar panels were sort of jutting out. Okay, well, we are on our way to the moon. I think we can just add an alarm there for the SOI change. It's 4 hours. Wonder why this one... Let me jump to that saltless. Wonder why it takes so long to get there. SVM, not... The saltless was the launcher. Gotta work on those saltless launchers. Okay, so why are you taking so long? Well, it looks legit. It'll actually get there after the launch we just did. But before I do anything else, why don't I get the other launch out of the way, the one to Minmus? That's a pretty dodgy one. And I'll show you why. Okay, so what you see here is, of course, the same first stage that we just used. So that's positive because we do intend to recover it, and it seems like it's recoverable. And with kickback boosters, with enough parachutes to recover those, I don't know how well they'll separate. Hopefully they'll separate cleanly. I forget if this booster requires separatrons. It is pretty big. But then things get complicated because I wanted to send a planetary base ink base to Minmus. And, well, this is the way I've decided to do it. So it's got its own little meerkat engines here, and they're not reading in the Delta V stats because they're facing that away. And it's got its fuel here. And then here is a planetary laboratory for Minmus science. And here we have a planetary habitat. Come to think of it, we should maybe have a little science on board, but maybe I don't know. I don't know if I want to put the scientific instruments on this or have a little science module that lands separately and then they can gather science from it. Either way could work in an interesting way. I guess I'll put one thermometer. But even those are pretty expensive around here. Okay, you can see we have extendable RCS to provide control, and our RCS tanks are up here because center of mass issues, it's better to put them up there. I don't know how much reaction wheel power we have on this thing. Not much, if I recall correctly. And there isn't a reaction wheel in the planetary base ink sort of form factor, interestingly enough, or maybe it's further along. Yeah, I didn't see one. So maybe we just haven't unlocked the technology, but I think the pod itself, let's see, there it is. The forward portion has one torque. So that's not much. If we add the planetary command module, we'd get four torque out of that, but we don't. We have a habitat here. And the habitat I don't believe has any internal torque. It's got a lot of other stuff. It's got supplies, but no torque. Speaking of supplies, as far as our interaction with USI life support, you can see that four Kerbals could be in here for 44 days with the supplies, and the habitation 105 days. Batteries, not so good, but we do have solar panels. And I've decided to opt for a V-wing sort of thing. It's sort of like an insect, I guess. Anyway, a docking port on top to control because the thrusters are going to be like this. Hopefully, that'll still be our center of mass. And yeah, it's going to be interesting. I am tempted to use one of these Lackluster Labs gyroscopes because, like, 40 torque is tempting, or at least maybe this Anthea control movement gyroscope. I mean, it costs a lot. It costs a lot. I mean, we could just plop it on there, and then we'd have a nice reaction wheel. I'll make a minor concession instead of something so powerful. Maybe two small reaction wheels. One here and one here. Maybe that'll be all right. I haven't put any lights, I know. And actually, it doesn't seem like I've got window shine on the planetary base ink part, so that's annoying. I know there is a pack for window shine for planetary base ink. But anyway, this side, so the decoupler is here. And then this is all fuel. And then fuel, and then there's a skipper here. So that's how it is. And of course, I've got stuff auto-strutted, right? Gotta have things auto-strutted. But I'll still put two struts on the tail here. Just in case. It'll make me feel better, because this looks weird. Yep. Was a little bit off, but we will have to assess this. At least we have a docking port on it. Now, there's probably something I've forgotten. Oh, facility supporting at least 5 Kerbals. Let's make sure of that. Yeah, we've got the planetary habitat and the planetary laboratory. It seems like 5 Kerbals, even though for some reason USI life support only read max 4. So maybe that's a bit off. I don't know. Okay, but in theory, 5 Kerbals. Docking port, yes, can generate power, solar panels, but then we have to have 2 scientists at the outpost to fulfill the contract. So, we're going to send Rodsby. I know this is bad of me. And then we have to hire 2 scientists, Greg Bro and Randall. Now we've got our max number of Kerbals. Maybe we should wait before sending them. Yeah, we'll do a crew transfer vessel. Let's just have Rodsby pilot the thing. Yep, that's the idea. Okay, so now we have an antenna. All right. The antenna is blocking the thermometer. Hold on. Let me put the thermometer off to one side. That shouldn't hurt anything. Okay. All right. Well, this is dubious, but let's go for it. Save. 1 Rodsby. Launch. All right, well, look on the bright side. It's not spontaneously exploding on the launch pad. Do the planetary base sink parts have internal lights? No, apparently not. Well, not like that. I guess I can turn lights on like this. It's a nighttime launch. Let me tune up ambient light adjustment so we can see things. But I'm not gonna time warp to morning or anything because you've got other missions underway as well. Thrall is up. SAS is on. Well, this is a dodgy one, but here we go. Launch. Aerodynamically, who knows? I have no idea about the aerodynamics of having the modules like this without a fairing. Well, that's smoother than I thought it would be. Okay, Sep. Okay, they separated cleanly. Good deal. We seem to have a sideways wiggle to us. After this burn, we'll coast to apoapsis before lighting the skipper. We're going pretty high already. Okay, Sep. Sep. Okay. All right, Thrall is down. We'll ignite the skipper. But we don't need its help just yet. I wonder how well the skipper is actually pointing through the center of mass of all this. Okay, let's light the engine. A little bit of pitch necessary, so not exactly through the center of mass, but not horrible yet. I say yet because these tanks are gonna go empty, and that's gonna change things. Well, this is a different kind of rocket than I've ever seen before in Kerbal Space Program. I don't know about you guys, maybe somebody has built something like this to deliver the planetary base sink modules. Of course, it's a good question whether I should be even using the planetary base sink modules instead of the colonization ones, but they are cheaper. I have to say, this whole setup is relatively cheap. So, that's nice. But the functionality might be a little bit lower. At least with the USI stuff. Okay, that'll be good enough. 142 by 81. And let's plot for Minmus. Alright, we seem to have a good Minmus encounter. We're burning out of the node here, and the periapsis there is 34 kilometers, so that's pretty good. And it'll only take the fuel in the skipper stage, which is great. That means our base has plenty of fuel to actually make the landing. Oh well, get into orbit and make the landing. So, good times. Let's point at the node. It's going to take some time to turn. Taking a look at our recovery stuff. Well, the core only had a recovery percentage of 86.3% because it got further out this time. Terminal velocity was okay. As far as the boosters, those were 97.2%. Terminal velocity a little bit higher than 6, but we got all of them back. That has been managed. Really, our main concern now is keeping the cost of the payloads down a bit. They are pretty expensive. Oh yeah, it's having a little bit of trouble controlling it. Alright. I'll only go 1/3 thrust. I think it can handle that. I'm not using the RCS yet. I could. Let's see, RCS on? I don't see them oh. That seems to have made things worse, if anything. I don't see little bursts of RCS. But they're using mod propellant, quite a lot of it, too. Let me turn that off. I don't know, wait until it's time for that. Well, our plot will be off. Jeez. I think one... Oh, it's actually drawing fuel. Oh, no, it's not. Let me pump fuel from the tank on this side into here for now to help balance things out. Right now, things are so unbalanced. Okay, let's see how that's going. Let's not have Smart ESS follow the node anymore. Alright, well, I guess we've expended that fuel a little bit early. Okay. Pump that back in here. Separation. Ooh. Little bit bumpy. Let me, I wish I could see where the bursts of RCS were actually pushing me. If they're actually pushing me. Let's see. Yeah, that's working. I just can't see him. Okay. We don't actually need the RCS. We're going to control from here. Uh-oh. I just noticed that I guess I've got the decoupler on the wrong way. We do have... I mean, that's gotta mess things up. I was hoping that this would be flat on the ground, but we do have the landing legs at least. So, maybe it's not too bad. Okay, well, 178, 179 kilometers. I guess that'll be alright. Got an encounter in 14 days. Rodsby can deal with this as a habitat for 29 days. That's interesting. Maybe that's because we haven't expanded the habitat. Let me deploy... Oh, the habitat can't be deployed. Well, if we say start habitat, what happens? Well, we don't have any problems with our electric charge, so that's the first most important thing. And, okay, now we have 389 days, so we just need a start habitat. Good deal. Okay. Let's add an SOI. Oops. Let's add an SOI change alarm for 13 days. And it looks like the next thing we need to do is work on our power distribution unit and get that landed at our base on the moon. Alright, time to turn our orbit. A little bit of an expense for us, but... That should be good enough. Let's get over to Periapsis. I don't know when exactly we can arrange a landing at the base. Depends on where we are relative to it. It looks like after we make orbit, maybe the next pass we'll be able to hit that location. Hit the base. That would be good. Don't like any delays. Especially since our Kerbals don't like this as a habitat. Maybe we can go a little bit tighter. Okay. Inconvenient to have the apoapsis on that side, but this will do. Okay, let's time warp a bit. Nope, we've got another alarm. Oh, the SVM is coming into the SOI. Okay, well, let's create a maneuver here so I don't forget about this. We will make it a landing maneuver. And we'll adjust our inclination there so we pass over the base. Alright, and then we will add this to the alarm clock. And now let's turn to the SVM. Now this is more particular because we need to make sure that this can dock to the base, to the existing station. So let us take a look at where that is. Okay, well, if we do it just right, we can meet it right about there. Okay, well, we should have enough delta V to make orbit and the rendezvous. Let's get rid of this alarm and add the new maneuver as an alarm and switch back to the power distribution unit. Holy mackerel, there are a lot of lines around here. Lots of stuff going on. Let's do the whole landing guidance thing, show landing predictions. Okay, retrograde me. Okay, that's an approach. Let's see. Is this the best view? Well, we're not close yet. Surface velocity. That's pretty close now. We need it within 150 meters. We're coming down sharp. Paying attention to that suicide burn countdown. Got 747 meters per second left here. Once we drop the payload, we'll be better off. Let's get the landing gear down. Those don't deploy like that. Okay, deploy. Up, we've deviated out of the 150 meter thing. Okay, which way do we go? Which way do we go? Alright. Okay, I don't want to land right on top of anything though. 27 meters right now. Oh, we're not really... I was measuring from the wrong thing. I got a little bit closer. Don't be greedy though. Careful, careful. Oh, whoa, that's not careful. Come on. Whoa. No! Ah! Oh. Well, shoot. Okay. We appear to have landed our power distribution unit sideways. It's not very helpful. I was trying to do too much there. Should have just landed it straight without trying to get closer to the base. Okay. Well, let's get rid of this. I guess we'll separate off the orange. I don't think even with RCS we can turn this. It's very blocky, you see. I mean, yeah, it's just gonna make things worse. So let me decouple and see if we can get the orange. Nah, it's 538 meters per second. We're not gonna get it to orbit or anything. Let's try and dispose of it, maybe. We don't want it hanging around the base, because then it's just gonna be debris and causing lag and such. So we'll crash it into the ground somewhere else. Okay, we've gone too far away. Let me switch to the base. No, I don't want to time warp. Stop that. So I guess I'll need sort of a winch. I know that KAS does such things, but we'll need to sort of like winch this up somehow. We need to send a rover over to do that. But I guess we can start the reactor even though it's sideways. Start reactor. Well, electric charge is resupplying. It's got all the uranium and all. It's got two Kerbals on board. Is it distributing? Okay, is there any sort of start distribution? I don't think so. So it should be distributing power to the base, right? This is the base. No, electric charge seems to be what it is. Operational. No PDUs in range. It says PDU range 2 kilometers. So it's not a PDU itself? I mean, well, 2,000 meters. Well, on the bright side, at least they have the shared habitat. So we are within the 150 meters for the habitat stuff. Transfer pod launch Sigmor Kerman. What was he supposed to do again? Totally forgot about him. Okay, well, so we've got a reactor running. But are you a PDU? Do you have a PDU in here somewhere? All the power. Kerbnet access? Not really. So if we start all the other stuff, it probably won't be good on the power. Start agroponics, start had common. Yeah, look, the electric charge is diminishing again. So I guess we need one of those really, really expensive power packs after all. I don't know. I thought these had PDUs built in. Level up crew. Oh, right. Well, we did send up pipes, so hold on, let me try and get to, oh yeah, that's the one. So maybe our engineer can EVA. Actually, could you knock this entire module over without let's see. I'm curious. Can you just bump, 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 bump? No, not really. Okay, nope, don't get stuck. So come on. Oh, we've got Nerf jetpacks here too? Well, shoot. I didn't realize we had realism overhaul EVA jetpacks here. Okay, well, that's gonna make this a longer walk, but we'll try and connect the carbonite power unit to the base. You do have your inventory, right? Yes, you do. Cool. Now, I wonder whether we can actually attach the little KAS port to the inflatable parts, or whether we're going to have to find a non-inflatable part to attach it to, in which case that might be out of range of such a part. So let's see, inventory, equip drill. Okay. Let's get nice and close. Right. Alright, no, attach. Oh, target part does not allow surface attach. Alright, cancel. Well, why don't we retract this one? Just so it doesn't get in the way. Ah! Oh, we could move that thing, but given my recent landing experience, I'm a little bit nervous about it. Cancel. Oh. See, I'm already going wrong. Oh, fudge. Yeah. I'm doing bad things. Can you just roll it over there? That should be close enough, right? Right? Maybe we can even expand that out. Okay. Seemed to have that little bit hanging loose, I thought. Okay. Alright, here we go, Georgie. Let's move the port over to the other side and then try and connect them up. Please, oh please. Link. Alright, they're linked. Let me step to the side here and say, can we deploy that? Oh, shoot. We retracted it. Now we need another 8,000 material kits to deploy it again. Oh, man. Okay, why don't... Georgie, why don't you just go inside, huh? Okay, well now it's all linked. We've got carbonite, we've got electric charge, let's start running things, start agroponics. In both of those. And headquarters. Looks like the electric charge is balanced and we're in nighttime. So it's not because of any solar panels, it is from our carbonite generator here. I think. I assume. Nothing to harvest on carborundum, but it's got 0.08 per second of carbonite. And it doesn't need any because carbonite's all filled up. Yep, carb electric generator, 4.96% load, so plenty of capacity. Alright, well, it could be worse. And we've accomplished something here. Let's check our habitability. Jeb, Bill, wow, home for 23 years, but anyway, 1 year, 249 days for Samrina, Jeb, Bill, Georgie. So that's excellent. Electric charge is much better than it seems. And unfortunately, our supplies at the base, 29 days of supplies. Samrina's got 132, but so next thing we need to do is a supply drop. And let me actually make an alarm for that, because I'd probably forget otherwise. So we're going to call this Mun Supply. Now, the question is, do I need a supply drop given the fact that we're doing agroponics? Oh, are we actually doing aquaponics? We're missing fertilizer. Right, we're not actually doing aquaponics. We need fertilizer. We should look in the VAB to see what we should send for as fertilizer. So, time interval, date. I think, let's say 20 days. Okay. That's a good idea. Okay, but before we do that, let's get the SVM into orbit so that we fulfill that contract. Okay, here we go. Let's delete that alarm, and I think right about there would be a good time to start the burn. We've only got tiny little twitch engines. Smart ASS, please, and ignition. Okay, that's orbit. But we have to be careful. We really want to make the rendezvous happen. Okay, that seems to be a minimum. 2.5 kilometers. And then we will take care of the rest of the difference between us and the target once we get there. It's possible that if we do the rest of this 176, we'll get another closest approach. But I'll wait on it. I would rather just match with the target. Actually, we should be... build a new orbital station around the moon. We've already completed the contract. So that's done. Nope, just point at the target. Let's have the target turn as well. This looks like the only available... we've got a docking port on this side too. Which would be better? This is a construction port. I don't think the port I have on here is a construction port, is it? No, it's a regular docking port. Now, I've had construction issues with the construction ports in a live stream recently. I hope they're all right. And here, let's test whether the RCS ports actually work. Yes, they do. Wow, they are powerful. They are powerful. They got us to a high velocity relative to the target without me actually intending to. And I had actually thrust limited them to 25% too. So they're a bit OP right now. Let's go 9%. Okay, turn that off. Well, okay, now I can set as target, yes, finally. Uh-oh, we suddenly ended up with a residual roll. Oh, I guess, I turned off Smart ESS. It shouldn't have decided to start rolling on its own. Okay. Every day a new thing. Oh, SAS is really not stabilizing things. It doesn't like these RCS ports, I don't think. I don't know. Come on, standard Kerbal magnetism. Yes. Phew. Okay. Alright, it's funny that these are turned... The reason why I was worried that they were radiators is because they're turned differently, but I think that's just because the sun is where it is. So, oop. Maybe that'll be alright. Okay, well anyway, our modules are joined. We now have a fancy station here. And there's nobody on it. That should probably be changed. Maybe Sigmor Kerman can come on over here. We'll see. I forget what he's on, actually. I don't know how much space we have. Probably a lot. We've got this Kerbitat here. And if we start HAP quarters... It doesn't draw any extra electric charge, so I guess that's okay. But anyway, let's stop that for now. There's no point. Okay, let's go to the VAB and see about that whole power distributor unit thing. Okay, so here we are. And what I thought was the case was that here we have power couplers, receives power from nearby power distribution units, and this... What we sent over there was a power distribution unit. And this said, power coupler receives power from nearby, fine, but it's a power distributor. distributes power to nearby power couplers. Okay, and then each of these has a power coupler, right? This has a power coupler. Requires landed or splashdown. Fine. I think everything should be counting as landing. Landed? Maybe because it's on its side, it's not counted as landed. I don't know. Landed or splashdown. See, each of these, they all have power couplers. And receives power from nearby power distribution unit. So I wasn't out of my mind that it should be possible. And the range of this is 2 kilometers, which our base is clearly within. Long range power distribution. Radiators not included. I hope it doesn't need radiators. It seemed to be doing all right. Let's visit it again and then wrap the episode up with that. We'll have to wait until the next episode to see about our Minmus base. Okay, so here we are again. Let's turn on the lights, by the way. Okay, so no PDUs in range, but it is a PDU. So we don't care about that. It is a PDU. And it's generating power. It's got power. The drain of the uranium won't even show. It's so small. Thermal efficiency is fine. Core temp is fine. Okay, to the base. Let's stop. Oh, let's right click here. What, does it also say no PDUs in range? Power coupler, 1 PDU. Okay. Now let's shut down the generator here. We see electric charge drain. Substantial electric charge drain, pretty darn quickly. So what's the good of the PDU? How can we get the electric charge from the PDU to here? Why isn't it being distributed? Okay, folks, this is the question I want answered to. I want an answer to that question. We're fine on power, but why is the power not coming from the reactor when this says 1 PDU power coupler? It says range 50. I don't know what that refers to. But the PDU that we have over there in the reactor has a 2 kilometer range, and we're definitely within the 2 kilometer range. So, is it that this, it doesn't make any sense that has a 2 kilometer range, but this doesn't have the range to receive it? Not too sure why. We can start recycler here. That should boost our overall time here. Our supplies are a little bit boosted now. 60 days instead of 29 ish I think it was. Forgot to start the recycler, but now we've got the recycler going. Still, I would like to know the answer to that question, so hoping for that in the comments. I'll say thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did enjoy this video, please do press like. If you have comments about that and other suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below, and I'll see you next time.